everyone. I'm Maya Joshi. I'm here today with Dr. Tammy Hoffman. We are so excited to have her here all the way from Bond University in Australia. She just gave the opening lecture this morning at the KT scientific meeting here in Vancouver. So we are very excited to have her here with us now. Could you tell us a bit about yourself and how you're involved in knowledge translation?
Yeah, sure. So I'm a professor of clinical epidemiology in Bond University in Australia on the sunny Gold Coast. And so my research, I do a lot on helping researchers do research that's usable by clinicians so that they can actually use it with patients. And I also do research on helping clinicians help patients make evidence-informed decisions. So I work at a centre called the Centre for Research and Evidence-Based Practice, and I lead a research group called the Centre for Evidence-Informed Health Decisions. So both at the patient level, how can we help patients to use research to make decisions? Should I take this treatment? Should I take this treatment? Should I stop? You know, what's the best way for me to improve my health? And also we do some broader stuff on helping the public. So when they see news items and, you know, stories about health, how do we educate them about whether that's reliable research or whether it's just, you know, a clickbait headline they're best to ignore?
That's wonderful. As a patient myself, that's something that is very important to me, and I'm sure many of our viewers. So thank you for that work that you do.
Thank you.
So you just gave the opening lecture this morning. I know that you just came straight from it. If you don't mind, if you could give us some highlights from that lecture and what you spoke about.
Yeah, certainly. So the title of my talk was Patient-Oriented Knowledge Translation. Where does it start and where does it end? And I talked about the continuum of this process, in that researchers should be starting by asking questions that matter to patients. So what are the big uncertainties that patients would like answers to? So we've got to watch that we're doing research that's patient-oriented, not something the researcher really wants to know, but what do patients need to know?
It is so important. And so our organization is centered around arthritis, and it's something that is really important in our field, because before there was all of these aspects of living with the disease that were really important to patients, but they weren't being focused on in research. So like fatigue, well-being, sort of sleep patterns. So it's work like that you do.
And I think the arthritis field have probably done some of the most advanced work in this space. So I talked about, you know, asking the right research questions and then picking outcome measures that matter to patients. Because if we measure something that, yes, it's interesting to researchers, that doesn't help clinicians talk to patients about, will this treatment help me? Because what does help mean? Help on what? And so in arthritis, so you'd know about UMRACT, which is the core outcome set. And that was exactly, fatigue was one. I gave the history of that fatigue was only added in as one of the core things that trialists should measure once patients became involved.
Exactly, and that's one of the most, it can be one of the most debilitating parts of living with an inflammatory arthritis.
Yeah, so I talked about that, and as I said, UMRACT's a fantastic example, which has inspired lots of other clinical areas to do similar things with core outcome sets. And then I talked about how interventions that researchers, when they're describing the research, they need to describe the treatments with enough detail that a clinician can use it. It's no point saying this exercise therapy will, you know, improve your quality of life if you don't know what type of exercise, how often, how long,
were
the patient information materials being given. We need to put all of that into the research so that it's usable. And then right through to, we also need to encourage researchers to describe how much will a treatment help and how much might it harm. Because most treatments can have both benefits and harms, and if we want to make informed decisions, we need to be able to weigh up those benefits and harms. And so I highlighted that, you know, we need all of those pieces of information to do patient-oriented knowledge translation research.
Yeah, that's great. And so what are some of the best techniques that you've learned about for getting that information to patients to make evidence-based decisions?
So there's been a lot of work in something called shared decision-making, which is the collaborative involvement of patients and clinicians together to make a decision based on what matters to that patient. So, so clinicians can trigger that process by saying, you know, here's a decision that needs to be made, would you like to be involved? And then they go through the options, you know, what are your options? And sometimes one option is to just do nothing, is to wait and watch.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's a few treatment options, or it might be a testing option. What are the benefits and harms of those options? And then how does that weigh up for you? So how does that fit with your patients, the patient's values and preferences and circumstances and what's going on
Which
in their
life?
Which
is so important, like more than the biomedical context, but cultural context, what your occupation is, what's important to you.
Absolutely. And, you know, does one treatment involve an interruption to the daily routine much more than another one? Would one not work with, you know, your life and child responsibilities and care responsibilities? So, I mean, that can be triggered by clinicians, but it can also be triggered by patients actually saying to their clinician, you know, what happens if I do nothing?
Mm-hmm.
What are my options?
Mm-hmm.
What are the benefits and harms of each options? You know, how might this work? You know, what other things might I need to think about? And so we can go both ways.
Yeah. I know that as a patient, it can be tough sometimes having that conversation and knowing how to have it without the vocabulary or the tools.
Yeah.
So what advice maybe would you have for patients that, you know, want to start that conversation, but it can
be tough?
So
I think just keep in mind those few questions. You know, what happens if a clinician is saying, you know, you should have this treatment, say, well, what happens? Do I really need it? What happens if I don't do it? So that you know what's the natural history or the prognosis of something. That's kind of your baseline.
Yeah, that's great.
And then, you know, what are my options? And that should trigger a clinician to say, well, there's two options or five options or, you know, which ones might you want to hear more about? You might not want to hear about all of them. One might involve surgery or injections or drugs or there might be non-drug options, and you know that's your chance to say I'm not really interested in, you know, the drug option. I'd rather just focus on the non-drug. So that's your option, chance to say I'd like to hear more about those two, and then you can say how might this help me or how might this harm me, because you need to know both, and then is there anything else I need to think about?
And
we're slowly working on changing clinicians behaviours and the sort of the culture and around
patient health
engaging
provider,
in decisions. So it's a conversation.
Of course.
It really should be a collaborative conversation where the clinician's got expertise to bring into the conversation, the patient's got their expertise to bring into the conversation. So you need the both.
Exactly.
And you need the evidence. You need the research about what works, what doesn't work, and then it can all, in a nicely, can come together so that the patient makes a decision that's evidence-informed, that aligns with their values, and that they're happy with. They're not going to go away thinking, oh, I hope I've made the right decision, and even if they do, they can, you know, go back and the process can go over again.
It is so wonderful to hear that. As a patient, those are the things that are most important when making a decision for a treatment, and so it's really great that this is something that is being discussed so much and researched in this field.
So it's a field that's really growing. It's quite in its infancy, you know, the last sort of 10-15 years, but the momentum of it's really picking up, and I think governments and health organisations around the world are saying this is important. It's important for maximising the value of research, it's important for maximising the quality of care that patients receive, and it's important for patient satisfaction. So it's sort of, I always say it's win-win-win. It's win for patients, it's win for clinicians, and it's win for health systems. So it's something we really need to be trying to progress along as rapidly as we can.
Yeah, absolutely. So something I was just wondering about is you're from Australia. Do you see a difference in sort of KT methods or advancement in Australia compared to here or other countries?
I think in Canada it's much more organised. So you have, for example, this conference, you have the Knowledge Translation Canada Network and a conference every year dedicated to it. So that's we don't have that in Australia. And I think you also have at the CIA, the Canadian Institute of Health Research level, there's a strategy for patient-oriented research and a whole lot of knowledge translation guidance documents. So I think
in
terms of structures and processes and broad guidance documents, that Canada's really one of the best countries in the world for doing this.
Oh, well, that's great. We're happy to hear that. And it's great to have doctors and researchers from around the world being able to attend this conference to then, you know, hopefully bring back some of those things and we can share ideas.
That's right, because we shouldn't be, you know, it's silly if another country spends time developing it from scratch. We should be trying to minimize duplication
and
learning from each other.
Absolutely. So just wondering here for patients or healthcare providers that may be watching, if they wanted to sort of be more involved in KT activities, how would you suggest they do that, or could they start?
So I think at their own personal healthcare level, there's mm-hmm. those questions I talked about to try to trigger shared decision making. But I think from a involvement and research perspective, mm-hmm. I mean, patient involvement is just wonderful, mm-hmm. and it's actually quite hard sometimes to recruit enough patients. Mm-hmm. So, but normally at universities, if you can work out at your local university if they're doing research that's relevant to you. Mm-hmm. Do they have a database you can put your name on, and then when a relevant project comes up? There's also sometimes other databases in the community health areas where you can register your interest.
Mm-hmm.
And I think even some journals now are asking patients to get involved with reviewing the research that researchers send in and saying, well, that's not written in a way that, mm-hmm. you know, it's not research that's particularly helpful for patient decision making, mm-hmm. and you can volunteer at journals. So I think there's lots of opportunities, and it's probably about finding what's in your local area.
Yeah, and in what you're interested in. And absolutely.
And in, you know, like arthritis, mm-hmm. Canada and other areas, there's advocacy groups and patient support groups. So I think there's always lots of mm-hmm. opportunities to share a patient's wisdom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just one more thing that I was sort of interested. I try to look into new research to do with arthritis quite a bit, mm-hmm. and sometimes I find research that I feel like is so applicable to me and so important in my life, but then I read the paper and it's very hard to to sort of access that information when I don't have the vocabulary or the expertise. Mm-hmm. It sounds like what you're working on right now is to sort of help get that information mm-hmm. to clinicians and then to patients so that it can actually be used, which is really wonderful.
So I mean there's some sources of information. You're right, most research articles full of jargon, and even a lot mm-hmm. of researchers don't understand it. But some products, so for example the Cochrane reviews, which are systematic reviews which summarize lots of trials, they have a plain language section.
That's great.
Which is summarize it in more sort of public friendly language without all the scientific jargon. Mm-hmm. So they're worth looking for. PubMed Health, which is the PubMed database, is a National Library of Medicine database mm-hmm. of all research. They have a slight section of it called PubMed Health, and that's aimed at having more patient-friendly language articles. So you mm-hmm. can search PubMed Health, probably better than searching Google or
going
some other website.
All of this
And of course, if there's an article you find that you think, oh, is this relevant to me, bring it along mm-hmm. to when you see your clinician, because there might be more about it that you're not aware of, and they can help you interpret it and say why it may or may not be an option for you. I mean, it might, if it's a drug, it might interact with something you're already mm-hmm. taking, mm-hmm. or perhaps the research was done in people who were quite different to you, and mm-hmm. so bring it along. Most clinicians actually like it if, rather than saying, oh, I read something, you know,
somewhere,
should I do this?
Yeah.
Bring the article along.
That's
and have a discussion with your clinician, with it there, and they can talk about whether it's mm-hmm. applicable to your situation or not.
That is wonderful. Thank you so much.
You're
this is
welcome.
Such helpful advice for myself and for, I'm sure, many of our viewers at home. So thank you so much for joining
us
today. And we will be back with our next guest shortly.